Colors and pixel art are extremely important, because even if you don't know much about color theory, you do feel the difference between a great color palette and a, well, less good one. You might not be able to put your finger on what exactly is off here, but you do notice that you enjoy this color palette much more, right? And of course you want your own pixel art to have that same effect too, so let's look behind the curtain of what actually makes a great color palette and how you can easily create one in Aseprite yourself. By the way, if you just want quick results and you don't care too much about creating your own color palette, you can find many great palettes out there on websites such as lowspec.com or pixelart.com, which you can download and use in Aseprite. And this is perfectly fine and a great way to focus on other aspects of your pixel art journey without having to worry about colors for now. But creating your own palettes is actually a lot of fun and can be very rewarding. And your choice of colors can also shape your individual style as a pixel artist in the long run. And after all, creating a palette is actually not that hard if you know a few simple tricks. So the first thing you might be wondering is, should I create a palette before I put down even the very first pixel? Or can I create my palette on the fly during the creation of my art piece? Well, my answer is, it depends. If you're creating a single piece of art, starting with only a few main colors and creating and tweaking the palette as you go is not a bad approach. If you're creating many different pieces that belong together, such as a tile set for a game or just game art in general, things become a bit trickier. Because you want to make sure that the colors throughout the game are cohesive, work well together and convey the same vibe. At least the colors within the same level, stage, biome or whatever you have in your game. In that case, it can pay off to first create a great color palette and then stick to it for the entire project as much as possible. However, in order to do that effectively, it helps to already have some practice and deeper understanding of creating color palettes. So I would say don't stress too much over it in the beginning. Either way, it never hurts to just start creating the palette for the first couple of pieces as you go to get a better feeling for what you are creating and then merge and narrow it down to a great palette you can stick to. Okay, but how do we do that now exactly? Before we even pick our first color, take a moment to think about the mood that you would like to convey. Are you aiming for something happy, cheerful, fun, or even cartoonish? Then choose warm colors, such as yellow, orange, or red, and go for high saturation and brightness. Or do you want to create something more serious, deep, sad, maybe even dark and depressing? Then choose some cooler colors, such as blue, purple, or green, and make them dark and much less saturated. Once you know what you're aiming for, pick a few main colors that convey that mood. If you have a reference image, you can also extract those main colors from the reference image by using the eyedropper tool in the menu or by pressing I on your keyboard. By the way, you don't even have to open the reference image in Aseprite yourself or even select the eyedropper tool yourself. If you move the cursor over the color selection in the bottom left corner and you click and drag, Aseprite will automatically select the eyedropper tool and allow you to pick any color on your screen by hovering over it, even outside of Aseprite or even on a second screen. So if your reference image is open in another application, for example, this is a quick way to extract some colors for your palette from there. With this method, you can even pick the colors used in the Aseprite application itself, or even from your Windows desktop, if you ever want to do that without creating a screenshot first. Anyhow, when picking the first few main colors, try not to overdo it and pick only 1 to 3 main colors to start with. In general, less is better when it comes to pixel art color palettes. But why is less better? First of all, a limited color palette enforces creative use of the colors you pick. The results are often much cleaner and more readable compared to using many redundant colors. Especially as a beginner, you might tend to make very literal color choices. You want to pick green for grass, blue for water, yellow for the sun, etc. And while this is not necessarily a mistake and can in fact work well if you have some experience, doing this as a beginner will often make your results look amateurish. If you have less colors to work with, you will automatically start using them for objects that you might not have considered before in that color, which can result in great and impressive pixel art. And in fact, the real world out there can also present us some unusual colors in places that we maybe aren't always consciously aware of. And reflecting that in your pixel art can look amazing. With our first few colors picked, we can now start adding lighter tints and darker shades for those colors. This way we can show our main colors under the influence of light or in the absence of light. What we are creating now is called a ramp within our color palette. A ramp is a sequence of colors in our palette that shows the progression of a base color from dark to light. Eventually, our palette should consist of several such ramps. And there are a few simple tips to keep in mind for creating such ramps, which will make your color palette look great. From each color to its adjacent lighter color in the ramp, we change all three of the HSV color components. If you don't know what HSV means, have a look at any color in Aseprite and click down here, where you can see the RGB values of that color. And right next to it, in this tab, you can see its corresponding HSV components. HSV stands for Hue, Saturation, and Value. Hue is essentially what we would casually call the color. So with this slider, you can determine whether you want something red, green, blue, yellow, orange, purple, or anything in between. Saturation then determines how much of that hue should come through. Think of it as the amount of color pigments in traditional paint. If you have a lot of red pigment in your paint, you get a highly saturated color. If you have less pigment, you get a more dull variant of that color. In digital art, turning down the saturation means shifting your hue more towards gray. The third component, value, determines the brightness of your color. A value of 0 means pure black, and increasing the value then shifts the color towards the lightest variant of your chosen hue and saturation. As a quick side note, there is also the HSL tab next to the HSV tab, in which you will find also hue and saturation, but instead of value, it gives you a slider for the lightness of your color, which ranges from pure black to pure white. I will not go into the exact science behind the different color models in this video because the HSV tab is sufficient for what we are going to do. But just let me know down in the comments if you would like me to create a separate video on the different color models in the future. Back to the colors in our ramp. As I said, when we go from one color in our ramp to its lighter neighbor, we should adjust all three of the HSV components to get a great looking palette. Many beginners only increase the value from dark to light within their ramp. What you then get are ramps like this. To give your color palette a significant quality boost, we therefore also adjust the hue and saturation for the colors in our ramp. This technique is often called hue shifting, even though we actually shift both hue and saturation at the same time. We shift the hue within our ramp such that the darker colors become cooler by moving them towards blue or purple. The lighter colors, on the other hand, should become warmer and hue shifted towards the color of the main light source in our image, which is usually a tint of yellow, orange, or white. For saturation, a good rule of thumb for beginners is try picking slightly less saturated colors than what your intuition might tell you in the beginning, because many beginners tend to overdo it. But then again, it's your art, right? And you can go as saturated as you would like, so feel free to experiment. But how do we shift saturation now within our ramp? Well, there's an easy answer and there's a slightly more advanced answer to this. The easy answer is always make the darker colors less saturated and the lighter colors more saturated. Basically letting the saturation follow the value progression within your ramp. Doing this simple trick will already give you pretty good results compared to doing no hue shifting at all. But if you feel that you got this and you would like to take things even one step further, then have a look at this. In color theory, each hue has a different distribution of saturation along its brightness scale. What that means is that it depends on the hue at which brightness value the color has the biggest saturation potential. Yellow or green are indeed most saturated in the brightest values. But for blue or purple, it's actually reversed. The highest saturation potential is in the darker tones there. Red, on the other hand, has its highest saturation potential somewhere in the middle along the brightness scale. So if you would like to take your color palettes to the next level, you can take this part of color theory into account as well and choose the saturation of the colors within the ramp accordingly. Look at this piece, for example, in which the blue tones are saturated with the easy method. When we instead reverse the saturation distribution following the more advanced method, we get this result. No matter what method you use, you now have a few simple rules to create nice looking color ramps within your palette. But there are a couple of more tips and tricks for you to make the process easier. Aseprite gives you the option to create a gradient between two colors automatically. So if you want a smooth transition from one color to another, you can place those colors in your palette with some empty slots in between like this. When you then select the colors, go to the Sort and Gradient menu up here and select Gradient. Aseprite then will fill the gaps based on the two colors that you selected, essentially creating a ramp for you automatically. So let's inspect what Aseprite has created here. By the way, in the palette window, if you don't want to click a lot with your mouse, you can move from one color to the next using the square brackets on your keyboard. Also, if you want to see the HSV dialog permanently on your screen, you can bring it up by clicking here and then dragging it to another location on your screen. This way, it will stay visible even when you move the cursor away from it. So, as you can see, Aseprite has in this case created a color ramp that nicely follows the principles that we discussed. You see in the color spectrum that the ramp follows a nice smooth arc. Lighter tones shift towards white, and the darker tones shift towards blue. The brightness increases with lighter tones, and in this case the saturation is highest at the darker end and decreases towards the lighter end, because we have a blue hue here, which tends to have that saturation potential according to color theory. So letting Aseprite create ramps for you can be a quick shortcut to get some initial results. But creating and tweaking your colors manually is still the preferred way to develop your own style and become more experienced with colors in pixel art in general. Another tip I have for you is that you can mix colors in Aseprite yourself. If you have two colors in your canvas like this, you can put them onto two separate layers and make them overlap. If you then select the top layer and press F2, or right-click and select Properties, you can reduce the opacity of the top layer to something smaller than 100%. This way you can mix in the color of the top layer into the color of the bottom layer. If you want to create a 50-50 mix, for example, set the opacity to 50%. The new color on your screen can then be added to your color palette. Make sure that you're in RGB mode and use the eyedropper tool to pick the mixed color and add it to your color palette by clicking the exclamation mark down here. As I mentioned earlier, avoid creating too many different colors in your palette. This also means that you should check every now and then if there are colors in your palette that are too similar. In that case, decide for either one of them, or mix them together with the method I just described, depending on what works best for the piece you are creating. It is also good practice not to have separate individual ramps in your palette, but to instead let the ramp share colors from other ramps wherever possible. Many pixel artists like to present their palettes by having the ramps laid out like a crossword puzzle, which is a great way to give a good overview of how the palette is organized and which colors are shared by multiple ramps. Once you have all the colors in your palette, you can do some finishing touches for the entire palette at once. If you check the brightness contrast menu or the hue and saturation menu by pressing Ctrl and U on your keyboard, you can tweak the entire palette with those options accordingly. I wouldn't go too crazy with those settings, because if you take the tips in this video into account, there shouldn't be a need to do drastic changes to the entire palette at the end. But it is good to know that the option is there, so again, feel free to experiment. Once you have a great color palette, you can start using it for all kinds of cool stuff, such as a dramatic sky with some impressive clouds. And if you would like to see some tips for beginners on how to create exactly that, then you can watch this video next, and I will see you there in a bit.